George Hill was an FBI employee working out of the Boston field office, and he talks about the pressure that the Washington field office was putting on Boston, and when they tried to get predicate evidence, they couldn't get it for a very interesting reason. This is George Hill.
The Lamont said, no, we're not opening up cases of people who went to a rally. And I got a cue card. The SSA for CT2 said, happy to do it. Show us where they were inside the Capitol, and we'll look into it. To which WFO said, we can't show you those videos unless you can tell us the exact time and place those individuals were inside the Capitol. To which the SSA responded back, and I was privy to these conversations firsthand, why can't you just send us, give us access to the 11,000 hours of video that's available? Because there may be UC's undercover officers or CHS's confidential human sources on those videos whose identity we need to protect.
Marcus Allen, an FBI analyst who did work around evidence, sharing it with folks. He saw videos that concerned him about the federal government's own involvement in January 6th. Here's Marcus Allen.
Problems with the investigation as far as informants were concerned, and our organization's potential forthrightness about utilization of informants there on that day that might have some impact on our cases and the subjects that we were looking up, and then just a general awareness overall for the investigation as a whole that there might have been some kind of potential federal involvement with the activities on January 6th, and I thought it was important enough that it wanted our attention.
So much of the good work happening at the FBI is throughout this country, and a lot of the rot the committee has learned emerges out of headquarters and out of the Washington field office. Garrett O'Boyle described the conflict that existed as the Washington field office put pressure on other field offices around the country to engage in law enforcement work without predication. This is Mr. O'Boyle.
Did WFO pressure other field offices to open?
I would say they pressured us to open cases to some degree. One example that I have personally, I made this is one of my protective disorders, so I'll just touch on it a little bit. But I received a lead about someone based on an anonymous tip. And in law enforcement, anonymous tips don't hold very much weight, especially without evidence that you can corroborate pretty easily. I wasn't able to corroborate anything that he said, even after speaking with the person they allege some kind of criminal behavior of. While I'm trying to figure all that out, I get another lead from the same agent who sent me that lead. And essentially trying to get me to violate policy or law.
Trying to get people to break the law without sufficient predication is a weaponization of our government.
These are some of the side effects of AI: privacy loss, mass surveillance, job displacement, growing inequality, cyber attacks, lethal autonomous weapons proliferation, humans getting hacked, human enfeeblement and loss of meaning, non-transparency, mental health problems from harassment, social media addiction, social isolation, and dehumanization of social interactions, threats to democracy from polarization, misinformation, and power concentration. Okay, first of all, I think we can see what's on these. We already have all these problems. AI is going to make them exponentially worse, but that's not even touching to the problems of what does full reality collapse mean. A survey of over 4,000 AI researchers last year found 48% of them, 48% give AI at least a 10% chance of causing human extinction. If you were going to the airport and the Boeing staff was there and half of them said there's a 10% chance that plane's going to crash, would you get on it? 69% of them say society should prioritize AI safety research more than we do currently. AI is the ultimate example of just because you can do something doesn't mean you should. And the people who have been running AI are now beginning to be afraid of AI. This is a presentation last month by Tristan Harris and Aza Raskin. They're from the Center for Humane Technology. Watch.
Anything that's not authentication based, you call your bank and I'm who I say I am. Anything that depends on that verification model, it's as if all these locks that are locking all the doors in our society, we just unlocked all those locks, right? And people know about deepfakes and synthetic media, but what they didn't know is that it's now just 3 seconds of audio of your voice before now I can synthesize the rest. And that's going to go, again, that's going to get better and better, right? So it's, try not to think about, am I scared about this example yet? And you might say, like, I'm not actually scared of that example. It's going to keep going at an exponential curve. So that's part of it, is we don't want to solve what the problem was. We want to, like Wayne Gretzky, sort of skate to where the puck's going to be. And with exponential curves, we now need to skate way further than where you might think you need to.
But just to name it explicitly, this is the year that all content-based verification breaks.
Here is an example of a terrifying AI capability that already exists.
So imagine you hook up to an AI, sort of just like you have two eyeballs and you can have, you sort of do stereoscopic vision between the two eyeballs. You have one eyeball looking at the images of where everybody's at in this room, how many people are here, what posture are they in. And you have another eyeball plugged into the AI that's looking at the radio signals of the Wi-Fi. And they basically said, could we have it train a bunch looking at both and counting the number of people, the postures that they're in, and then we close the eyeball to the AI that's looking at the image. So now we just have the radio signals. And just having Wi-Fi radio signals, you can actually identify the positions and the number of the people that are in the room.
Okay? So essentially, there is already deployed the hardware for cameras that can track living beings in complete darkness, also through walls, and it's already out in the world. In fact, it's everywhere that human beings go.
Just last week, scientists announced an AI tool that can translate a person's brain activity into text. In their experiments, researchers had a person lie inside of a brain scanner and listen to audio of someone speaking. The AI program then read the person's brain activity, and about 50% of the time, quote, the machine produced text that closely and sometimes precisely matched the intended meanings of the original words. The developers are talking about how this could benefit people who can't physically communicate, like stroke victims. But it's not a wild leap to see how this kind of AI deployed for other uses straight out of George Orwell's 1984, Thought Crime and the Thought Police. On the video that we just showed you from Tristan Harris, they also showed how you can currently, AI can read your dreams or interpret what you're seeing without it seeing itself. It is awesome technology. The world is about to get slammed with chaos surrounding authenticity.
That the Bureau was biased against former President Trump. A group of FBI whistleblowers giving explosive testimony on Capitol Hill. The witnesses accusing the agency of unfair treatment and alleging retaliation. Republicans say this is just further proof of what it calls institutional rot and anti-conservative bias. And adding to their argument, just before the hearing, the FBI yanked security clearances of two of the agents.
Working as an FBI special agent was my dream job. My whistleblowing was apolitical and in the spirit of upholding my oath. Nonetheless, the FBI cynically elected to close ranks and attack the messenger.
My family and I have been surviving on early withdrawals from our retirement accounts while the FBI has ignored my request for approval to obtain outside employment.
I never swore an oath to the FBI. I swore an oath to the Constitution.
Do you believe that the FBI is purposefully hostile to you for that reason, to keep agents from speaking up?
Yes.
Yes, no question.
Yes.
Chairman Jim Jordan warning the whistleblowers that they would face heavy attacks from Democrats.
We've talked to over 24 whistleblowers. People have come to us. We've interviewed several of those, and today three of them. Three of those brave whistleblowers and a lawyer who represents them will tell us their story. They will tell us what happened, what they saw, and then what happened to them because they were courageous enough to report it to Congress. I just want to tell you guys, get ready. Get ready, because these guys are going to come after you. You know they are.
Well, Jordan was definitely onto something. Democrats did bash Republicans for even holding the hearing and trying to undermine the credibility of whistleblowers.
On Police Week, watching House Republicans jump to lay the foundation to defund law enforcement. My colleagues on the far right are on a mission to attack, discredit, and ultimately dismantle the FBI. This is Defund the Police on steroids.
You're engaging in the self-promotion of your new book that's about to be released. And what great timing to be on TV and in Congress right before your book tour starts.
In Texas, we would just say that this is just a lot of hot air.
The primary allegation was that there was a cash incentive program with the FBI. So the more investigations a field office opens up, the more cash bonuses are given to the head of the field office. So that's why you're seeing this flurry of investigations, a flurry of arrests. That's why so many January 6th prosecutions, so many parents are being investigated. Catholics are now being investigated. And it explains why. Anybody who even went to D.C. on January 6th was investigated. They were investigated for money, but they were investigated. And Bank of America handed over to the FBI every single transaction that was made by people that flew into D.C. for January 6th. Not only that, the FBI was taking officers off child porn cases and making them hang out in the parking lots of parent-teacher conferences and write down their license plates. They made the Betsy Ross flag or a bumper sticker that said 2A a terror symbol. So now you understand why the FBI says white supremacy is the number one threat in the country. Because it's a predominantly white country, and you could make money, a fortune, investigating everything. A flag waver, a small business owner, a Trump supporter, a parent, anybody that can be considered white. You can open up an investigation and get paid for that. So it's a very perverse incentive.
That is why he must be impeached. But the death, allowing the death of over 300 Americans every single day, is like allowing people to be murdered every single day. It's just allowing it to happen and allowing murder, allowing crimes to be committed against American citizens is an absolute failure of the President of the United States. But I'll go further. I'm very invested into the investigations that we're doing on the Oversight Committee. These investigations are serious. And what we are reading in SARS reports and what we are seeing and studying in bank records, and we have more coming. We are only partly into this investigation. It's only been a couple of months. What we are finding out about not only Hunter Biden, which was known from the Biden laptop, from his laptop, but denied and lied about by 51 people, members of the intelligence community, who I'll tell you right now, those 51 should have their security clearances stripped from them. And I'll argue further that some of them should go to jail for what they did and how they abused their authority on the television to lying to all of you and lying to the American people.
Now to a major new development on the Dodgers Pride Night controversy. Late tonight, LA Pride said it was canceling its participation in the decade-old event that celebrated the LGBTQ community at Dodger Stadium.
The people who throw the biggest LGBTQ pride party on the West Coast just pulled the plug on the biggest LGBTQ pride baseball game in SoCal. LA Pride just announced it will not partner with the Dodgers this year to host LA Pride Night at Dodger Stadium on June 16th. This after the Dodgers rescinded an invitation to honor the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence with a Community Hero Award. Members dress as queer and trans nuns, promote LGBTQ causes, and mock some Catholic traditions, something the Catholic League protested earlier this week, explaining their objections to us on Wednesday.
She then pick a group that specifically targets, mocks, denigrates, ridicules Catholics. Is not a message of inclusivity.
They told us they've had problems with the group at other events.
Democrats in New Hampshire just struck down a bill requiring schools to tell parents about their children's gender identity. So we're semi going to stay with this topic right now because the states and this news is driving it. The state's GOP chairman hit back with this tweet. Once again, 100% of New Hampshire Democrats voted against parents knowing what is happening with their own children in our public schools. According to a conservative parents group, at least 168 school districts nationwide, governing nearly 6,000 schools, have guidance on the books to block parents from knowing about their child's gender identity. That covers more than 3 million children.
When college students join sororities, many of them do it for the sisterhood, for a place to belong, for lifelong friendships. They don't do it in hopes that a man will invade their personal space, staring at them silently, creeping them out. But that's exactly what happened at the Kappa Kappa Gamma House at the University of Wyoming, according to a new lawsuit. Six sorority sisters say they were forced by the national chapter to allow a man, Artemis Langford, into their women-only organization because Langford says he's transgender. The suit also alleges that he has watched members enter the house and sometimes had an erection visible through his leggings. Other times he had a pillow in his lap.
Laura, I just don't see a way out for them. They want everyone to believe that being a woman is nothing more than wearing lipstick and the pronouns that you use. And we all know that it amounts to womanhood. It amounts to a lifetime of experiences, and that's what they seek to deprive these young women of, and that's what we intend to fight for.
Now, Cassie, I guess Artemis doesn't live in the house, and according to the lawsuit, was given a waiver, so he didn't have to live there. Now, why is this?
Laura, we've seen extreme preferential treatment given to the individual involved, and it's very disheartening that when you're a 6'2", 260-pound man, you're treated as the victim in today's society. But the bylaws are very clear. This is an all-women's organization. Kappa was formed over 100 years ago to be that support system for women so that they could compete in the classroom against men. And now we just cease to exist. We're nothing more than an idea of self-identification.
Well, Allie, here's Artemis being interviewed by the school newspaper back in October. This was last year, talking about being admitted to your sorority, saying, "I feel so glad to be in a place that I think not only shares my values, but to be in a sisterhood of awesome women that want to make history. They want to break the glass ceiling, trailblazing, you know, and I certainly feel that as their first trans member." Allie, did you all sign up for trailblazing to have a man live in your sorority?
No, we certainly did not. When I joined back in the fall of 2019, I was promised a sisterhood, which obviously you would assume would be women.
Why do you say that the Adidas ad erases women?
Well, I think it's pretty clear. When you have a women's swimsuit and you put a man in the women's swimsuit to sell to women, okay. It really feels like you think that men can do it better than women. And I'm very confused here because I thought there was generations of feminists that stood up for women to get the equal treatment, to be represented. And now that same political ideology is standing up for biological men to replace women in the categories that should be meant for us, the spaces that should be meant for us. I know it feels to a lot of people like this is like faux outrage, but it's really not. This is telling young girls who are looking at Adidas, a mega brand, that they're not good enough to be a model for the brand, they're not good enough to be an athlete in their own sports, that biological men can do it better. What kind of message is that? A 200-pound biological man who wants to be in a sorority house with other girls, there have already been reports of him watching them undress, right? Being excited at watching them undress. The problem with this has all become really sticky because you have people who are transgender or think they're transgender, and then you have people that are using the label in order to be perverts and get away with it. And I believe that's what's happening in this case. And again, back to the same conversation. What happened to the feminists when they had the Me Too movement? What happened to the consent, right? You were always supposed to listen to women, believe all women. Now this makes us uncomfortable. All of a sudden, their voices don't matter. How did we get here?
Oh, and she-
shaming.